Once we go to our YouTube channel, the meaning of this lecture is discuss about the, some of the important formulas of the power system in a very, very detailed manner. And if you like the kind of channel, then please do like, share, and subscribe to the don't forget to press the bell button. So whenever I upload new video, the diagnosis comes to mind. If any witness here in a village, then please join the comment section. We will definitely include all those images in the comment section. So at this moment, so let's get started. The first concept that I am going to teach you is about the sequence impedance. It is a very, very important concept here, sequence impedance. So here, J1 is called as the positive sequence impedance, and J2 is called as the negative sequence impedance, and J0 is called as the zero sequence impedance. In the case of the fully transposed transfer line, J1 is always equal to J2, and both are lesser than J1. So in the case of the fully transposed transfer line, J1 is equal to J2 and both are lesser than J1. Means the positive sequence impedance is equal to negative sequence impedance and both are lesser than the zero sequence impedance. In the case of the silent pole alternator and solidly grounded alternator, the star printed, or you can simply call it as a generator also. So in the case of the silent pole alternator as well as solidly grounded alternator in the star printed, or simply you can call it as the generator, in this J1 is always greater than J2 and J2 is always greater than J0. Means the positive sequence impedance is always greater than the negative sequence impedance and negative sequence impedance is always greater than the zero sequence impedance. Okay? So in the case of the silent pole alternator as well as the solidly grounded alternator, in the star counted, or simply I can call it as the alternator, in these things always J1 is always greater than J2 and J2 is always greater than J0. So J1 is positive sequence impedance is greater than negative sequence impedance, and negative sequence impedance is greater than zero sequence impedance. Whereas in the case of the transformers, all the sequence impedance are equal. J1 is equal to J2 and J2 is equal to J0. Means the positive sequence impedance is equal to negative sequence impedance, and negative sequence impedance is equal to zero sequence impedance. It's a very, very important part we have to remember. So definitely, it's a very important concept we need to remember. So in the case of the nuclear power plant, I will tell you the first concept is about the nuclear power plant. I already told you in the case of nuclear power plant, we have two important things. One is the control rods, the other is the moderator. Okay? So basically, in the case of nuclear power plant, one neutron, if it is going to hit the uranium atom, three more neutrons are going to be liberated. So if this process continuously goes on, then what is going to happen? The number of neutrons will go on increases. If it goes on increases, definitely the reaction is uncontrolled. So we have to control. You want to control? Definitely we have to control the number of neutrons. If you control the neutrons, then you have to control the chain reaction. So how to control the neutrons? So in order to control the neutrons, we are going to do implement two things. One is a control rods, the other is a moderator. The basic cost of the control rods is to absorb the neutrons. The basic cost of the control rods is to absorb the some of the neutrons parallelly. Another, the function of the moderator is used to increase the speed of the remaining neutrons. The basic function of the control rods is to absorb the some of the neutrons parallelly. Another, the basic function of the moderator is to increase the speed of the remaining neutrons. So what is shortcut? Remember, CA, check the record. What is MS? MS office. So C means control rods, A means absorb, MS moderator, S means speed. Okay? So what is CA? Chart of the quant. What is MS? MS office. Shortcut remember. So the basic portion of the control rods is to absorb the neutrons permanently. Whereas the basic portion of the moderator is to increase the speed of the remaining neutrons. So what are the control rods? Rods are nothing but either it can, you can use either cadmium rods or the boron rods. So you can use control rods as either cadmium rods or the boron rods. So in the nuclear power plant, control rods, they can use it as either cadmium rods or the boron rods. It's a very important concept we need to remember. So let me tell you the other important concept. It's a basically small circuit here. So in this circuit, I'm showing it. This is the cable. This is a 4-head transmission line. So a cable is having some impedance, ZC. So cable is having some impedance, ZC. 4-head transmission line is also going to have some impedance, ZO. So now, here this is a surge voltage, which is basically, which is coming on the cable. The surge voltage is coming on the cable. So because of this, some voltage is going to get transferred into this 4-head transmission line. So what is this voltage? We have to figure out. So just apply the voltage division principle. VT is equal to VS into ZOL by ZC plus ZOL. But only thing is you have to multiply again 2a. Then it can be same as a movie division principle, which is a simple to do a by z c plus to do a. But you have to take an extra factor 2a. Then this is called as a bt. Bt is a transmitted. So surge voltage transmitted to the overhead transmission line. And what is VS? Surge voltage on the cable. What is ZC? Surge impedance of the cable. What is ZL? Surge impedance of the overhead transmission line. Same thing I showed here. What is ZC? Surge impedance of the cable. What is ZL? Surge impedance of the overhead transmission line. What is VS? Surge voltage of the cable. And what is VT? Surge voltage which is transmitted to the overhead transmission line. So VT is equal to VL. You can say ZL into VS by ZC plus ZL. What you want to multiply again? 2A. Just as a basic only division principle formula, this should multiply by 2 again. Overall, this is a formula you have to remember. What is it? ZC, the parasitic impedance of the cable. What is ZL? Surge impedance of the ZC plus the surge impedance of the cable. What is ZL? Surge impedance of the overall transmission line. What is VS? Surge voltage on the cable. And VT is a surge voltage which is transmitted to the overhead transmission line. It's a very, very important formula we need to remember. So now the next concept I will try to explain regarding the modeling of the transmission line. Okay. The modeling of the transmission line basically it depends on the wavelength only. Okay. So based on the wavelength only, we have basically modeled the transmission line into three categories: short transmission line, medium transmission line, and the long transmission line. So based on the concept of the wavelength only, we have modeled the transmission line into three categories: short transmission line, medium transmission line, as well as long transmission line. So you know the basic formula: distance is equal to speed into time. So distance I will assume it as a lambda, speed I will assume it as a d, time you know 1/frequency. And what is v? V is equal to lambda into f. Lambda I'm going to assume it as the length of the transmission line. So v is equal to l into f, where v is a velocity, l is the length of the transmission line, f is the frequency of the supply. Okay. So what is the unit of l? Kilometers. The length of the transmission line is a physical unit of the transmission line, and its speed is always in terms of kilometers. What is it? Frequency of the supply. Its speed is hertz means 1/s. And what is the velocity? So kilometer into 1/s is equal to kilometer per second. So the unit of l is kilometer. The unit of frequency is hertz of 1/s. And the unit of velocity is kilometer per second or kilometer per second. Call it. Okay. So now telling. So I'm already told you basically we are going to model it. Time into three categories: short transmission line, medium transmission line, long transmission line. So short transmission line means the velocity is like from 0 to 4,000 km/s. Then we say it is a short transmission line. So the velocity is going to lie between 4,000 to 10,000 km/s. Then we say it is a medium transmission line. So the velocity is more than 10,000 km/s. Then we say it is a long transmission line. So the velocity is going to lie between 0 to 4,000 km/s. We say it is a short transmission line. So the velocity of the it is lying between 4,000 to 10,000. We say it is a medium transmission line. The velocity is more than 10,000 km/s. We say it is a long transmission line. So the velocity is lying between 0 to 4,000 km/s. We say it is a short transmission line. The velocity is lying between 4,000 to 10,000 km/s. We say it is a medium transmission line. The velocity is more than 10,000 km/s. We say it is a long transmission line. So always the velocity should be in terms of kilometer per second. It's a very, very important concept we need to keep in mind. So now let me tell you another important concept regarding reserve capacity. Well, reserve capacity is a difference of the plant capacity as well as the maximum demand. So reserve capacity is equal to Pc minus P0. Yes, the difference of the plant capacity and the maximum demand. So you can also write it in the other fashion also, which is the maximum demand into load factor minus plant capacity factor by plant capacity factor. So you can use any of this formula in order to get the reserve capacity. So it is a Pc minus Pmax or Pmax into load factor minus plant capacity factor by plant capacity factor. So what is load factor? Load factor is the ratio of the average power by the maximum demand. Okay. Average load by the maximum demand by here in the Pmax. Okay. What is plant capacity factor? It is a ratio of the average load by the plant capacity means here is by Pc. So always remember, load factor is the ratio of the average power by the maximum power or average load by the maximum demand. What is plant capacity factor? The ratio of the average load by the plant capacity or here is by Pc. Okay. It is a very important formula related to it. Okay. Now, the next formula is the SAG. We have the basic formula of SAG. S is equal to WL squared by 8T. S is equal to W L squared by KT. Where S is equal to the maximum sound which can occur in the transition layer by deceiving this variance in terms of meter. Okay. What is W? Weight of the transition line per unit length, which is kg per meter. What is the span length? It is in terms of meter. It is the maximum allowed tension on the transition line, and its unit is in terms of kg. Okay. So as you can see clearly from this picture, therefore what I can say, S is equal to W L squared by KT. So this is called as the maximum sag in the case of the torsion line, and its unit is meter. The W is the weight of the torsion line per unit length, which is kg per meter. Where L is the span length, and its unit is meter. That is the maximum allowed tension in the torsion line, and its unit is kg. So if you try to subscribe these units, what we are going to get? Weight unit is kg per meter. And kg per meter, and the length unit is meter. So it is equivalent to meter square. Right, tension unit is nothing but kg per kg, okay? It is dimensionless, it's a number, so it has no unit here. So here you can see meter square, meter transverse, kg per transverse. Finally, you are going to get meter. The unit of the side is nothing but meter. Same thing I have shown here. So always remember, S is equal to W squared by 80. S is equal to W squared by 80. But S is a maximum sag, which is possible in the case of transition line, and its unit is meter. And W is the weight of the transition line per unit length, and its unit is kg per meter. And L is a span length, and its unit is meter. AT is a maximum allowed tension in the transition line, and its unit is kg per meter. It's only kg, okay? T is a maximum allowed tension. Maximum allowed tension in the transition line, and its unit is kg, okay? So the next point is about the inductance per phase. So this is a very important concept. What is the inductance per phase? Let me try to explain. It is finally out number. Inductance per phase is equal to mu of V R by pi into ln of D by R dash, Henry per meter. Okay. This inductance per phase is per meter. This is the Henry per meter. Okay. Inductance per phase is equal to mu of V R by pi into ln of D by R dash, Henry per meter. What is mu of 4.10 in the power of minus 7? What is R dash? In the power of minus 1 by 4 into R, which is 0.7788 R. What is the distance between the conductors? What is the radius of the conductor? Okay. So this is the inductance per phase. What if you want the inductance per phase for some amount of length means for this form of this formula here in terms of meters, radiometric transverse, we are going to get the overall inductance for that much of amount of length we are going to get. So this is what I have done. L phase, capital L means this is the inductance per phase for that much amount of length. So if you multiply the value of L in terms of meters for this expression, then we are going to get this one, which is L plus into the length of the quantity in meters. So this form is just going to discuss that one, you are multiplying with the corresponding length of the quantity in meters. So if you multiply these two things, then we are going to get the overall inductance of the phase. For that amount of length, we are going to get the value in terms of angle. If you need to cancel solely, we are going to get in terms of meters. So always remember the basic formula. My meters per phase is equal to V naught V R by pi L naught V by R dash D by V naught. L naught is equal to 4.2 to the power of minus 7. R dash is equal to V naught power of minus 1 by 4 into R, which is 0.7788 R. Where D is the distance between the conductors. Where R is the radius of the conductor. Okay. So this is best in terms of L per meter. So if you want the inductance for a certain amount of length, is you have to multiply L for the above formula. Then you are going to get the overall inductance of the phase. For that much amount of length, you are going to get here. So what is the form? First, you have to multiply for this value. What multiply by the length of the quantity meters. So between the classes, overall, you are going to get the value of the inductance for that much amount of length that you are going to get here. Okay? It's a very, very important problem you need to remember. The next concept is about the bias differential area. The next concept is about the bias differential area. In which you have to remember a very important equation, which is K is equal to NR by NA. K is equal to NR by NR, where K is equal to biasing. If K is equal to biasing, NR is equal to the number of cross in the restraining coil, and NR is equal to the number of cross in the operating point. It's a very, very important form you have to remember. In the case of the biasing differential area, K is equal to NR by NR, where K is the biasing, NR is the number of cross in the restraining coil, and NR is the number of cross in the operating coil. It's a very important formula definitely you need to remember. So in the case of the, I continue. In the case of the bias differential relay, K is equal to NR by NR. K is the biasing, NR is the number of throws in the restraining coil, and NR is the number of throws in the operating coil. So, finally, I can tell you, it's a very important formula you need to remember. In the case of the bias differential relay, K is equal to NR by NR. Where K is the biasing, NR is the number of pores for the history network and NGN is the number of pores in the operating coil. So let me tell you some more important concept regarding the power plants. So basically we have two types of power plants. One is the base load power plants and the other is the peak load power plants. What is the meaning of base load power plants? Base load power plants are nothing but these power plants, they are going to these power plants are going to operate for the base loads. Because base loads will be present for all the time. So definitely these are going to be present for all the time. They will take lot of time in auto shut and also they will take lot of time in auto turn off also. But as a peak load plus another thing, these plants, they can easily, you can easily turn it off and you can turn it off at whatever instant you want. Okay? So that is the reason these plants are as a peak load plants. So whenever any peak demand comes, then we can on this one in order to create those demands. So what are the base load plants which are nothing but hydroelectric power plant, nuclear power plant, thermal power plant and runoff river. Okay, these are basically base load power plants. Then what are the peak load plants? Peak load plants are nothing but pump storage and diesel. Because you can easily turn it off and turn it off whatever the instant you want. So because of this reason, you can use these plants in order to meet the peak demand. So that is the reason these are of course the peak load plants. So base load plants are nothing but hydroelectric power plant, nuclear power plant, thermal power plant and runoff river. Whereas the peak load power plants are nothing but pump storage and diesel. Okay. The next one is about the I'll discuss some facts about the coarse-seeding load-flow method. So I'll discuss some important facts regarding the coarse-seeding load-flow method. So isn't it clear? The choice of slack bus is going to affect the convergence. The choice of slack bus is going to affect the convergence. See, whenever you try to, in the case where we have taken one that is a slack bus, okay, you got some result. In the case where you have taken the other bus as a slack bus, so because of that, you are going to get the other result. So these two results are, there is some amount of variation. So definitely, the choice of slack bus is going to affect the convergence. So as you choose a slack bus, the result that you are going to get is also varying. So that is the reason. So the choice of slack bus is going to affect the convergence. Unreliable convergence means, change the slack bus, the results that you are going to get is different. But that is the reason it is unreliable. Unreliable, the answers are different, right? That is the reason we said it is unreliable convergence. Smoke, rest for the smoke emissions. What are the reasons that you are going to get? It will take a lot of time. That is the reason it is a slow convergence. The result that you are going to get is it will take a lot of time. That is the reason it is called a slow convergence. Any initial guess for voltage can be taken because it won't affect the convergence. Yes. See, initial guess you can take anything because it won't even affect the convergence. So, any initial guess for voltage can be taken because it won't affect the convergence. You can take whatever the initial guess you want. You can take any initial guess you want because it will never affect the convergence. So you can take whatever the initial guess you want. You can take it. It won't even affect the convergence. So any initial guess for the voltage can be taken because it won't even affect the convergence. Okay? So you can take whatever the initial guess you want. You can take it. It will never affect the convergence. So one of the important facts is the possible method. Which is nothing but the choice of slack bus is going to affect the convergence, and it is having an unreliable convergence as well as the slow convergence. Any initial guess for voltage can be taken because it is not going to affect the convergence. Okay? So finally, let me try to clear this concept. So whenever you are reading a slack bus, definitely you are going to get different results. So that is the reason the choice of slack bus is going to affect the convergence, and also another difference, because as you are reading a slack bus, each time we are going to get a different result, so definitely I can say this is unreliable convergence. But still, it will take a lot of time, that is the reason there is slow convergence. So any initial guess you can take for the voltage because it is not going to affect the convergence. Whatever the initial guess you want, you can take it. It is not going to affect the convergence. So any initial guess for the voltage can be taken because it is not going to affect the convergence. These are the important points regarding the possible load flow method. So let me tell you another important cause of this. It is the velocity of the electromagnetic field. The symbol is PA. There is a basic formula. V is equal to 1 by under root over epsilon into mu. 1 by under root over epsilon into mu. What is epsilon? Epsilon into epsilon. What is mu? Mu naught into mu. So epsilon naught value we know. Mu naught value we know. This epsilon simplifies. Then 1 by under root over the epsilon into mu naught. This simplifies. Finally, you are going to get PA into 10 power of 8 by under root over epsilon naught into mu naught. Let me look at this one. This is epsilon naught. Okay. So this is epsilon naught. Okay. This is epsilon naught. So now, you can see clearly here. meter per second. So this is one that we are going to get here. This is the value that we are going to get. So now, if you see clearly, I've already told you exponent value, you know, you have the value, you want to substance simplify, finally what you are going to do? 3 into the power of n by epsilon r into mu meter per second. What is epsilon? Permittivity. What is mu? Permeability. Okay. What is epsilon? Permittivity of the free space. What is epsilon? The relative permittivity of the medium. What is mu? The absolute permeability of the medium. What is mu? The relative permeability of the medium. Okay. So, for the vacuum as well as air, so you know epsilon r is equal to 1 as well as mu r is equal to 1. So, for vacuum as well as air, what are you doing here? For vacuum as well as air, epsilon r is equal to 1 and mu r is equal to 1. Then what is the velocity we are going to get? 3 into the power of 8 meter per second. Okay. But in the case of any dielectric medium, then epsilon r is greater than 1 and mu r is also greater than 1. So, if you take any other dielectric medium, definitely epsilon r is greater than 1 and mu r is also greater than 1. So, definitely the is very high, so the overall ratio will decrease. So therefore, what I can say, the velocity of the EM wave in the case of the air and vacuum is always higher than compared to the velocity of the EM wave in the case of the dielectric medium. Because, you know, in the case of the electric medium, this V0 is very high actually because of the overall ratio will decrease. So that is the reason the velocity of the EM wave in the case of the air as well as vacuum is always greater than compared to the velocity of the EM wave in the case of the electric medium. Is a very important concept. You always need to keep in mind. So therefore, I can tell you finally, the velocity of the EM wave in the case of the air as well as vacuum is always greater when compared with the velocity of the EM wave in the case of the electric medium. Because in the case of the electric medium, epsilon r and mu r are always greater than 1. So because of this, the V0 is very, very high. So therefore, the overall ratio is very, very less. That is the reason I can tell you. The velocity of the EM wave in the case of the air as well as vacuum is always greater when compared to the velocity of the EM wave in the case of the dielectric medium. It's a very important point to remember. So now, the next important point is, basically, we have a lot of faults in the case of the power system. Out of that, what is the most severe fault, which is the trivial G fault? And what is the least severe fault, which is the LG fault? It's a very important point, always you have to remember. Okay? So, I already told you, out of all the faults, what is the most severe fault? Trivial G fault. Because we have the fault curve will be very, very high. And what is the least severe fault? Which is the LG fault. Okay. So, this is a very important point. Always you have to remember. So, I continue. Out of all the faults, the most severe fault is the LG fault. And the least severe fault is the LG fault. What is trivial? Trivial G? Trivial G means trivial line to ground fault. What is LG? Line to ground fault. So, trivial is also cause of three phase. So, here, three phase to ground fault. Okay. Trivial is cause of three-phase fault. Actually, trivial fault is cause of three-phase fault. So, trivial G means three-phase to ground fault. So, I can tell you, the most severe fault is the thing of trivial G fault or the three-phase to ground fault. And the least severe fault is the line to ground fault. Okay? Or LG fault. So, more severe means fault count is very, very high. Less severe means the fault count is very, very less. Okay? That is what I am trying to tell you. So, fault count is more means it is the most severe fault. Fault count is very less, so it is also least severe fault. So, out of all the faults, the most severe fault is the trivial G fault or the three-phase to ground fault, and the least severe fault is the LG fault. Okay? So, now the next question is about the energy. So, what is the formula of energy? V is equal to H into S. V is equal to H into S. So, basically, we have two cases. Suppose in the case one, suppose E1 is equal to E2, then what is going to happen? H1, H1 is equal to H2, H2. Okay? In the case 2, suppose E is equal to E1 plus E2, then what is going to happen? H into S is equal to H1, S1 plus H2, S2. So this is the case 1 and this is the case 2. Suppose E1 is equal to E2 means H1, S1 is equal to H2, S2. Suppose E is equal to E1 plus E2 means H into S is equal to H1, S1 plus H2, S2. What is the kinetic energy to store in the rotor when rotating at a synchronous speed in the generator? See, definitely the rotor is going to rotate at the synchronous speed. The rotor is going to rotate at the synchronous speed. So at the time, it is going to have some amount of kinetic energy. Like that is happening at E. And this will be joule. Okay? So E is the kinetic energy stored in the rotor when the rotor is rotating at the synchronous speed in the generator. And this will be in terms of joule. What is H? H is the inertia constant. And this will be second. Okay? What is this? Rating of the generator. And this will be volt ampere. So you know basically, H is having a unit of second. Okay? H is having a unit of second. And the Because this is how we use all the volt ampere. And what we are going to do? The volt ampere is nothing but watt only. And second, what is the thing of the joke? So we are going to do joke. That is the reason. We use the energy of this one is joke, which is the initial constant, and this one is second. This is the reading of the alternator, and this one is volt ampere. We use the kinetic energy stored in the rotor, and the rotor is rotating in a synchronous rotating generator, and this one is joke. It is the initial constant and this unit is second. And this is the reading of the generator and this unit is volt ampere. So always remember, E is equal to H is in the place of if E is equal to E2, then H and S is equal to H2 and S2. In the place of obviously if E is equal to E1 plus E2, then H and S is equal to H and S1 plus H2 and S2. So this is nothing but the kinetic energy is going to store in the rotor and the rotor is going to get at the synchronous speed in the place of generator and this unit is true. And this is the initial constant, and this unit is always second. And this is the reading of the generator, and this unit is volt ampere. This is a very important part. Always you have to remember. So, you know, this is the H unit is second, and the unit of the S is volt ampere. So, volt ampere is second, what only? So, volt is second, nothing but joule. Like this, you need to remember. So, the next part of the way I'm going to tell you is about the impedance. Impedance. So, Z is equal to R plus J omega L. It is a ohm per meter. Y is equal to J plus J omega C. Mho per meter. Y is the impedance, Y is the admittance. So, Z is equal to R plus J omega L. Ohm per meter. Y is equal to J plus J omega C. Mho per meter. Now, what is Zc? Zc is the characteristic impedance. It is a ratio of the Z by Y. So, what is Zc? Characteristic impedance. It is a ratio of the Z by Y. So you know the value of J, you know the value of the perception of what you want to do. But R plus J omega L, J plus J omega C. And the resistance and the inductor, these are connected and C is the capacitance. Z is the impedance and Y is the admittance. It is also equal to root to what? J do C into J do C. What is OC? J do C, open circuit impedance. Okay? What is J do C, short circuit impedance. Okay? So it is also equal to root to what? Open circuit impedance into short circuit impedance. Okay? This is a very important part we need to keep in mind. So it is also equal to another to open circuit impedance into short circuit impedance. What is open circuit impedance? Vs by Is when IR is equal to 0. What is ZSC? Vs by Is when IR is equal to 0. So open circuit means I open the load, then definitely what is the current IR? 0. Then in the ratio Vs by Is. Short circuit means just take the load and short circuit the output terminals. And what is VR? What is VR? VR is equal to 0. So in that case, try to find the value of Vs by Is, that is for short circuit impedance. So open circuit impedance is a ratio of the Vs by Is when IR is equal to 0. Short circuit impedance is a ratio of the Vs by Is when IR is equal to, sorry, when VR is equal to 0. So open circuit impedance is a ratio of Vs by Is when IR is equal to 0, because I have removed the load. So IR is equal to 0 in that case. What is short circuit impedance? It is a ratio of the Vs by Is when VR is equal to 0. Short circuit impedance, I open the load and I will take the short circuit, so we are equal to 0 in that case. So this is a very important formula you have to know. And what is surge impedance? Surge impedance is nothing but in the case of characteristic impedance, just substitute R is equal to 0 and G is equal to 0, then you are going to get the surge impedance. So in the case of characteristic impedance, just substitute R is equal to 0 and G is equal to 0, then you are going to get the surge impedance. So if you substitute R is equal to 0 and G is equal to 0, then what are you going to get? J omega, J omega cancels, we are going to get R root of L by C. L by C you are going to get. So what is capital L? L1 into L1. What is capital C? C into L1. Okay. Here L1 is nothing but is a inductance for meter. Okay. C is the capacitor for meter. Okay. L is the total inductance for this much amount of length. And C is the total capacitance for this much amount of length. So if you substitute, what are you going to get again? So what is something the same thing you have to do? It is a characteristic impedance. If you substitute R is equal to 0 and G is equal to 0, then we are going to get the surge impedance. So what do you have got? R over L by C. L is equal to L1, and the C is nothing but C by L1. So L1 cancels. So we are going to get R under root of L by C1. So you can see here, the surge impedance is always independent of the length of the transition line, because here L1 cancels. So therefore, it is independent of the length of the transition line. So therefore, that is the reason the surge impedance is always independent of the length of the transmission line. Okay? So what is the unit of L1 and the parameter? What is the value unit of C1? Farad per meter. And what is the unit of L, which is angle? And what is the unit of C? R. Because here, so now we are going to multiply by L1 means we are going to this much of the inductance for this much amount of air. If you are going to multiply by L1 means y arguyendo que diez por ciento que acabas de diez por ciento de plan hay otra familia que salió permita hay otra feliz Henry hay otra opción está de permita hay otra opción para what is it él es un problema de trabajo sino él es un business en caso de trabajo se le mira esto él es un business en caso de trabajo es serio el problema por lo que tiene se ve que el problema es que vamos a ver que tiene so now the next thing is, the next question is about the wind power. It's a very important question always you have to think. What is wind power? P is equal to A into rho into B square into V cube. So P is equal to A into rho into B square into V cube. This is called as a wind power. Okay? P is equal to A into rho into B square into V cube. What is P? Power in the wind. Okay? What is V? Positive. What is rho? S2 of the wind. Then these are the diameter of the turbine. What is V? Velocity of the wind, the wind velocity. So always remember, the examination they will ask you like this, what is the relation between P as well as V? So P is the proportion to V cube. So therefore, P is the thing that P is equal to A into rho into V square into V cube. Then P is the thing that or in the wind. P is the cost of, rho is the cost of V. V is the diameter of the turbine and V is the wind velocity. So the question you ask me, please add the question to me. So in a lot of exams, I am going to ask the relation between P as well as V. And the question will be in the argument, which is please add the question to me. So always remember, P is equal to A into rho into V square into V cube. A is the power in the wind, A is the cost of, O is the, I can say, density of the wind, and V is the diameter of the turbine, and V is the velocity of the wind, or wind velocity. So finally, I can tell you, P is equal to A into rho into V square into V cube. Where P is the power present in the wind, A is the cost of rho is against of the wind, B is the diameter of the turbine, or the or turbine diameter, B is the velocity of the wind. So always remember P is the proportional to V cube. Okay? So now the next concept is, in what relations are required to explain here? Rho factor is the ratio of the altitude by the maximum load. Rho factor is the ratio of the altitude by the maximum demand. Okay, maximum demand. So altitude is the P average. Maximum demand is P max. Suppose if I multiply by P and divide by T in the both sides, then what I am going to get? PR is into P by P into P max. So PR is into T is nothing but power term is nothing but energy. So energy by T into P max. Okay. This is P max here. Estimate is okay. You can write here P max. So if you see clearly one important point, I will try to explain here. We try to reason carefully. What is E? E is nothing but this much amount of energy is consumed in this much amount of time. Okay. E is nothing but this much amount of energy is consumed in this much amount of time. Then P max. Energy in this kilowatt hour, time in this hour, P max in this kilowatt. So, next, the tank capacity back is the ratio of the output by the tank capacity, which is PR over PC. And what is utilization factor is the ratio of the P max by PC. The maximum load by tank capacity is P max by PC. So, I can write this one like this. So, I can write this one. This P average by P max into P max by PC, I can write like this. So this is something about load factor. And this is something about utilization factor. So therefore, long capacity factor is nothing but the multiplication of the load factor as well as the utilization factor. Okay. And if you see clearly, PR is always less than P max. So definitely this one is always less than 1. So PR is always less than PC. So maybe so this one is also less than 1. P max is always less than PC. So this one is also less than 1. So that is the reason. Load factor, plant capacity factor, and utilization factor is always going to lie between 0 to 1. Okay? So, as you can see clearly, the load factor, the plant capacity factor, and utilization factor, these values are going to lie between 0 to 1. Okay? It's a very important point you have to remember. So, let's get another important point. So, regarding the cable, we'll try to understand. So, R is always used to proportional to A. So, you can see R and L is always equal to cost. What is R? Insulation resistance of the cable and L is called as the length of the cable. So it's a very important constant in the case of the cable. R is always inversely proportional to L. And you can also say it as the R into L is always equal to constant. R is called as the insulation resistance of the cable and L is called as the length of the cable. So this is a very important formula in the case of the cable. So always remember R is always inversely proportional to L. Or we can simply say R into L is equal to constant. R is called as the insulation resistance of the cable. And it is called as the strength of the cable. Okay? So now let's go for the other concept, which is regarding the transmission line. So in the case of transmission line, X is always inversely proportional to L. See, X is nothing but 1 by omega C. So one by n we can say c is equal to constant of 1 by n. So also what we can say c is equal to constant here. So c is equal to constant here. So this all is basically for the clamshell line. This is called as the charging reactance of the clamshell line. And L is the length of the clamshell line. And C is the charging capacitance of the clamshell line. So this constant is for the clamshell line. And this constant is for the KB. X is always in the proportional to L. X is equal to 1 by omega C. So I can tell you finally C is equal to proportional to L. When X is called as the charging reactance of the clamshell line. And L is the length of the transmission line. And C is the charging capacitance of the clamshell line. Okay, it's a very, very important formula. We have to remember. So whenever you think of the clamshell line, always remember X is always inverse proportional to L. X is equal to 1 by omega C. So finally I can tell you C is equal to proportional to L. Where X is the charging reactance of the clamshell line. And L is the length of the transmission line. And C is the charging capacitance of the transmission line. So I will tell you some important points regarding the 8-mesh circuit breaker. So there are different types of circuit breakers. Some important points I will try to explain in the case of the 8-mesh circuit breaker. So here, always resistance circuit breaker or resistance switching is always used. Okay? In the case of 8-mesh circuit breaker, always resistance circuit breaker or the resistance switching is always used. And also, capacitor switching bank is also used in the case of the air blast circuit breaker. And auto reclosing of the circuit breaker is also used in the case of the air blast circuit breaker. Okay? So whenever you think about the air blast circuit breaker, you have remember these 3 points, which is in this we can use the resistor circuit breaker and the resistor switching, as well as capacitor switching bank also we can use, and also auto reclosing. So these 3 things we can use in the case of the air blast circuit breaker. Okay? So whenever you think about the air blast circuit breaker here, you always prefer the resistance circuit breaker or resistance switching, capacitor switching back as well as auto reclosing. So whenever you think about the air blast circuit breaker, always remember 3 important points, which is in this we are going to prefer the resistance circuit breaker or the resistance switching. And also we are going to use the capacitor switching back in the case of the air blast circuit breaker, as well as auto reclosing is also done in the case of the air blast circuit breaker. So always remember, whenever you think about the air blast circuit breaker, these 3 important points always you need to remember, which is in this resistance circuit breaker or resistance switching is basically used in the case of the air blast circuit breaker. Capacitor switching bank or the capacitor switching is used in the case of the air blast circuit breaker, as well as auto reclosing is also used in the case of the air blast circuit breaker. So now I'll tell you some important points regarding the air blast circuit breaker. So whenever you think about the air brake circuit breaker, 2 important points always you have to remember. One is here magnetic node coils are used. In this, magnetic node coils are used, and it is having the lowest outer voltage when compared to other circuit breaker. Okay, so out of all circuit breakers, this air brake circuit breaker is going to have the very lowest operating voltage when compared to other circuit breaker. Okay, these 2 important points you have to remember. So whenever you think about the air brake circuit breaker, always remember this. We are going to use the magnetic load coils, yeah? And also it is going to have the very lowest operating voltage when compared to any other circuit breaker. So it is going to have the very lowest operating voltage when compared to other circuit breakers. So always remember, whenever you think about the air brake circuit breaker, here we are going to prefer the magnetic load coils, and also here we are going to see the circuit breaker is going to have the very lowest operating voltage when compared to any other circuit breaker. So finally, I can tell you, which is whenever you think about the air brake circuit breaker, always remember 3 important points, which is in this we are going to use the magnetic load coils. Okay, and also it is going to have the very lowest operating voltage when compared to any other circuit breaker. So finally, I can give you a summary of these 2 concepts. Whenever you think about the air brake circuit breaker, always remember 3 important points, which is in this resistance circuit breaker is used, resistor switching is used, capacitor switching bank is also used in the case of the air blast circuit breaker, auto reclosing is also done in the case of the air blast circuit breaker. And whenever you think about the air brake circuit breaker, always remember 2 important points. Here, the magnetic load coils are used, and also it is having a very low supporting voltage when compared to any other circuit breaker. So now let me tell you some important concepts regarding the DC distributor. Suppose if L is the length of the distributor, L is the length of the distributor, and using this meter, R is the resistance per unit length, and using this ohm per meter, R is the current per unit length, which is ampere per meter, VD is the voltage drop in the distributor, and using this volt, PL is the power loss of the distributor, and using this watt. Okay, So we, I'm going to use the expression of the VD and PL in the terms of these remaining parameters. So VD is equal to I into R into N square by A, and PL is equal to I square into R into N cube by 2A. Okay? These are the very two important formulas you have to remember. R is the length of the distributor, R is the meter. R is the resistance per meter, which is 1 per meter. I is the current per meter, which is ampere per meter. VD is the voltage drop in the distributor. And is in this fold. And as PL is the power loss in distributor, and is in this one. So I'm going to give the relation of the VD as well as PL in terms of these three parameters, which is VD is equal to I into R into N square by A, and the PL is I square into R into N cube by 2. So how do you remember? Very simple, everything. See, P is very higher, right? So P is very high, means denominator is also very higher. If VD is very less, right? So denominator is also very less. Shortcut to remember. So here VD is less, so denominator is also less. Here PL is more, so denominator is also more. Right? And see, we can check digital process in terms of units also. We can check in terms of units. So what is the unit of the current, which is here? Ampere per meter. Okay? And what is the unit of the resistance here? Per meter. And what is the unit of the length, which is meter? So square of the meter square. It is dimensionless. So now if you see, meter, it expects the answers. R into O is nothing but volt. So the volt is here, I unit is volt here, okay? Single here. What is the current unit here? Ampere per meter. So we are doing square, right? So ampere per square by meter square. Then the resistance unit is here, 1 per meter. So the length is meter, so meter square. There is dimensionless, so it is a number, there is no dimensionless. So meter square, meter, it cancels. So ampere square into O. So ampere into O. Ampere into O is nothing but voltage. Voltage depends on the power, so therefore what we are doing is the same thing, power expression. So if you know English, you can take this value and you can cross up. Same means you should always get. So always the word VD is called I into R into N square by A, and PM is I square into R into L cube by 2. Okay? These two expressions always you have to keep going. So VD is called I into R into L square by A, and PL is I square into R into L cube by 2. Okay? Is a very important expression you have to remember. So now I will tell you one more important concept regarding the buses. So I'll try to explain the different types of buses which are used in the power system. Basically, we have three types of buses. In the case of the power system, we have three types of buses. One is the load bus, it is also called the PQ bus. Then next one is the generator bus, it is also called the PV bus. The next one is the slack bus. Slack bus is also called as the reference bus. So basically here three types of buses. One is the load bus, it is also called as a PQ bus. The other is the generator bus, it is also called as a PV bus. The next one is the slack bus, it is also called as a reference bus. So basically we have four parameters. So total we have four parameters, which are PQ, mod V and delta. So out of these two things to be non-conscious, the remaining two things will be unknown quantities, right? So out of four parameters, what are the four parameters? P, Q, mod V and delta. Out of this, two are the known parameters and the remaining two are the unknown parameters, okay? So in the case of load bus or PQ bus, P is known and Q is known. The remaining two are unknown, it is mod V and delta, okay? In the case of generator bus or the PV bus, P is known and mod V is known. The remaining two are unknown, it is Q and delta. In the case of slack bus or reference bus, mod V is known and delta is known. So P is unknown and Q is unknown. Let me tell you, let me try to repeat this concept again here. So basically buses are of three categories. One is the load bus or the PQ bus. The other is the generator bus or the PV bus. And the other is the slack bus or the reference bus. So total we have four parameters. P, Q, mod V and delta. Out of that, for everything, two will be known and the remaining two will be unknown. So for load bus, P and Q are the known parameters. The remaining two are the unknown, which is mod V and delta are the unknown parameters. For generator bus or the PV bus, P and mod V are the known. So the remaining two things are unknown, which is Q and delta. Slack bus or reference bus, the known quantities are the mod V and delta. The remaining two quantities are unknown, which is P and Q are unknown. See, slack bus is nothing but it is generator bus only, okay? One of the generator bus is taken as the slack bus. So what is a slack bus? Slack bus is nothing but it is one of the generator bus only. So one of the generator bus is taken as the slack bus. Sí, es que vas a tener un genital bus. La genital bus are going cutting bus or colon genital bus, okay? So, suppose let me assume there are total 10 nodes are there, okay? Let me assume there are 10 nodes, okay? Out of that, 8, so let me tell you, 8 are the genital buses, means 8 are the, for these buses, I can tell you the genitals are connected, okay, for 8. And the remaining two are the load buses, okay, load buses, okay? Now tell me, listen carefully, how many load buses are there? Two. Genital bus, out of these 8 genital buses, one bus are going to as well as slack bus. So now tell me, now, how many genital buses are available? Only 7. And the remaining one is the slack bus. So writing now, they understood. So out of 10 buses, 2 buses are the PQ buses, 8 buses are actually 8 buses are genital buses, but out of them, one is taken off the reference bus. The remaining 7 are the genital buses, and the remaining one is the slack bus. So slack bus is nothing but this genital bus only. So slack bus is nothing but this genital bus only. But out of all genital buses, one genital bus we are going to, as well as slack bus, the remaining thing we have to input for the genital buses, okay? So this is a very important point we have to remember. So now let me tell you some important factors here. So let me tell you some important factors here. This is a new concept. Diversity factor is a diversity factor. So this is a diversity factor. What is the formula of a diversity factor? The diversity factor is nothing but it is a ratio of the sum of the individual maxima demand of the consumer's by maximum demand of the power station. So maximum demand of the power station. So sum of the individual maximum demand of the consumer's by maximum demand on the power station. Okay. What is the diversity factor? It is a ratio of the sum of the individual maximum demand of the consumers by the maximum demand on the power station. So numerator is always greater than denominator. So that is the reason this value is always greater than 1. Okay. Diversity factor value is always greater than 1 because the numerator is always greater than the denominator. That is the reason I can tell you this ratio is always greater than 1. So let's remember diversity factor is a ratio of the sum of the individual maximum demand of the consumers by the maximum demand on the power station. So this ratio is always greater than 1 because the denominator is higher when compared to the numerator is very higher when compared to the denominator. Okay? The numerator value is always greater when compared to denominator value. Okay. The next thing is that demand factor. So demand factor is the ratio of the maximum demand by the collected load. So what is demand factor? Demand factor is the ratio of the maximum demand by the collected load. So what is demand factor? Demand factor is the ratio of the maximum demand by the collected load. Because I can tell you it is a reverse of the diversity factor, okay? So maximum demand by the collected load. So collected load will be always higher when compared to maximum demand. See, simply it is a reverse of the diversity factor, okay? So maximum demand will be very lesser when compared to collected load. So that is the reason I can tell you this ratio is always lesser than no. Demand factor is nothing but is a reciprocal of the diversity factor. Simply you can see clearly here. So therefore, I can tell you these two important formulas you have to remember. Diversity factor is the ratio of the sum of the individual maximum demand of the consumers by the overall maximum demand on the power station, and its value is always greater than 1. And demand factor is the ratio of the maximum demand by the collected load. Okay, so this way, this ratio is always lesser than 1. So it is a basically temperature is a reciprocal of the diversity factor, as you can see clearly from this one. Okay, so collected load will be very, very higher when compared to maximum demand. That is the reason this ratio is always lesser than 1. The next concept is, I'm going to tell you about the moderator. The next concept is about the moderator. So, let's say, there are basically different types of nuclear power reactors. So, in this nuclear power reactors, what is the moderator that we are going to see? We'll try to discuss. What is the basic cost of the moderator in order to reduce the speed of the neutrons? So, I think we have basically four types of reactors. One is the fast breeder reactor. Second one is the Kondo reactor. Third one is the liquid metal polar reactor, and the fourth one is the boiling water reactor. So in the case of the fast reactor, we are going to use the heavy water as the moderator. Okay? Whereas in the case of the Kondo reactor, we are going to use the heavy water as the reactor. Okay? Whereas in the case of the liquid metal polar reactor, we are going to use the graphite as the reactor, as the moderator. In the case of the boiling water reactor, we are going to use the ordinary water as the moderator. Okay? So always remember, in the case of the fast breeder reactor, we are going to use the heavy water as the moderator. And in the case of the Kondo reactor, we are going to use the heavy water as the moderator. In the case of the liquid metal polar reactor, we are going to use the graphite as the moderator. Whereas in the case of the boiling water reactor, we are going to use ordinary water as the moderator. Okay, this is a very important policy you have to remember. The basic portion of the moderator is to reduce the speed of the neutrons. So let me tell you another concept is about the cable. So you can see clearly, see this is the, it is a pure conductor. Although we are going to give some type of insulations. So this is the overall cable. So this inner port is having a diameter of small d. So overall cable is having a diameter of capital D. So this is the actual conductor part. The remaining thing is all about the insulation. Right? So the total conductor part is having a diameter of d, small d. And the overall cable is having a diameter of capital D. Okay? Then what is D? G is called the dielectric stress. Okay? Small d is the insulated cable overall diameter. Okay? And capital D is the insulated cable overall diameter. Okay? G is the dielectric stress. So what is the D? Small d? Small d is the diameter of the actual conductor. Then capital D is the overall diameter of the cable. Okay? Small d is the diameter of the actual conductor. Capital D is the diameter of the overall cable, as you can see clearly. Same thing you told me in the other version. Small d is the insulated cable over diameter. Capital D is the insulated cable overall diameter. And G is the dielectric stress. Now let's remember, G is always inversely proportional to diameter. G is always inversely proportional to diameter. So what I can say? So I can tell you like this. So G to D is always equal to constant. So dielectric stress and diameter is always equal to constant. So if G is maximum, diameter must be minimum. Is that much small d is equal to? If G is minimum, D should be maximum, which is capital D. Then only the product is always equal to constant. If G is maximum, means D must be minimum, which is small d. If G is minimum, means diameter should be maximum, which is capital D. Then what you can get? G max by G minimum is equal to capital D by small d. Okay? It's a very, very important question, obviously, you have to remember. Dielectric stress is always inversely proportional to diameter. So therefore, dielectric stress and diameter is always equal to constant. Okay? Because you know, dielectric stress is always inversely proportional to diameter. So I can tell you the other version also. Dielectric stress and diameter is always equal to constant. If G is maximum, D should be minimum. If G is minimum, D should be maximum. So therefore, G max into small d is equal to G minimum into capital D. So if you simplify, what we are going to get? G max by G minimum is equal to capital D by small d. It's a very, very important concept we have to keep in mind. So always remember, dielectric stress is always inversely proportional to diameter. Or you can also say it is dielectric stress and diameter is always equal to constant. So if G is maximum, D should be minimum. If G is minimum, D should be maximum. So therefore, G max into small d is equal to G minimum into capital D. So if you simplify, what we are going to get? G max by G minimum is equal to capital D by small d. This relation always is not to keep in mind. So now let me tell you some important concept regarding the string efficiency. So let me tell you some important concept regarding string efficiency. Always remember the string efficiency formula. Now, percentage of the string efficiency is equal to voltage across the string by the number of incident discs into voltage across the lowermost disc into 100. Into 100 I have not written. Okay? Into 100 I have not written. I think it should be into 100. That's percentage of. So always remember, which is the percentage of the string efficiency is equal to voltage across the string by the number of incident discs into voltage across the lowermost disc. See, what is the voltage across the lowermost disc? It's the disc which is very near to connector, that is called the lowermost disc. Okay? So whenever you go from the connector to the top of the tower, what is going to get? The voltage drop is going to get decreased. Okay? Whenever you go from the connector to the top of the tower, the voltage drop across the inclined disc will decrease. So whatever the disc which is very, very near to connector, the disc near the disc, the voltage drop will be very, very higher. So whenever you go from the connector to the top of the tower, I can tell you which is the voltage of the disc will decrease. The voltage of the disc will decrease. Okay? It's a very, very important point always you have to remember. So that is the reason the percentage of string efficiency is equal to voltage across the string by the number of individual discs into voltage across the lower most disc into 100. Okay? Now already told you whenever you go from the connector to the top of the tower, the voltage drop across the disc are going to get decreased. Okay? So the disc which is very, very near to the connector, that voltage drop will be very, very high. The disc which is very close to the connector, across the disc, the voltage drop will be very, very high. So when we go from ground clock, the voltage drop is going to decrease. And normal formula also you have to remember, the string efficiency always gives the proportional to supply frequency. Okay? The string efficiency is always inverse to proportional to supply frequency. So as supply frequency increases, the string efficiency will decrease. Okay? So whenever the supply frequency increases, the string efficiency decreases. Whenever the supply frequency decreases, the string efficiency will increase. Okay? It's a very, very important point, always you have to remember. Okay? So formula I can tell you, the string efficiency is always inverse to proportional to the supply frequency. So as supply frequency increases, the string efficiency decreases. If supply frequency decreases, the string efficiency will increase, as you can see clearly here. Okay? So now let's go for another concept. It is about the reserve. So basically in the case of power plant, we have three types of reserves. One is the spinning reserve, the other is the cold reserve, the other is the hot reserve. These are the three types of reserves which are available in the case of power system. Okay? Rho is nothing but operation, S is nothing but service. Okay? In the case of spinning reserve, I can tell you, in this the reserve capacity is in operation as well as is in service, okay? In the case of full reserve, the reserve capacity, it is not in operation, but it is in service, okay? In the case of hot reserve, the reserve capacity is in operation, but it is not in service, okay? Always operation is in service. So let me try to explain here. In the case of reserves, we have two types of reserves in the case of the power system. So, spinning reserve, cold reserve, and hot reserve. Spinning reserve is nothing but it is the reserve capacity of the power plant in which it is in operation as well as it is in service. Cold reserve means it is the reserve capacity of the station. It is not in operation but it is in service. But in the case of hot reserve, I can tell you, which is it is the reserve capacity of the power plant which is in operation but it is not in service. Okay? So, let me try to explain in a very detailed manner. Okay? Let me try to explain here. Let me take a power plant is there. Let me take a power plant, okay? This power plant is total rating capacity is just 10 megawatt, okay? So 9 megawatt we are supplying to load. 9 megawatt we are supplying to load. Remaining 1 megawatt, it is in operation. So for 9 megawatt we are supplying to the load. Okay? We are supplying to the load. Okay? So this 1 megawatt we have to extra. We have to put extra. Yes? It is basically it is in operation, so it is fully okay, it is fully perfect. Okay? But we are not using it to supply to load. We are not using it to supply to load. Yes, it is not giving the service to the load. Okay? Yes, it is completely, it is perfectly all right. Means it is in operation. Yes, it is perfectly all right. Okay. We have constructed, we have made this 1 megawatt plant, we have made everything. So it is perfectly in operation. But we are not using the service to meet the load demand. Okay? We are not using it. Which is service and not to meet the load demand. So what we can say? Yes, it is in operation, but it is not a service and not to meet the load demand. Okay? That is the meaning of hot reserve. Cold reserve is opposite of this one. Opposite of the other reserve is as a cold reserve. Yes, it is not in operation, but it is in service. Okay? Spinning reserve is, yes, it is in operation and it is also in service. So this name is called as the spinning reserve because it is in operation as well as it is delivering its power to the load. So it is giving its service to the load, right? It is in operation as well as it is in service. Okay? This 9 megawatt is nothing but spinning reserve. This 1 megawatt is nothing but hot reserve. Okay? So this is a very, very important point we have to remember. So, let me give you a small example. In the case of 10 megawatt plant, 9 megawatt is basically it is the supply to the load. 1 megawatt we have kept it extra. Okay? It is perfectly alright. It is perfectly alright. But we are not supplying this 1 megawatt to the load. Yes, it is perfectly alright. It is perfectly operational. It is perfectly operable. Well, it is perfect in operation, but we are not using its service in order to meet the load demand. So what I can say, yes, it is a reserve capacity of the power plant, it is in operation, but we are not using its service to meet the load demand. So what I can say, it is a hot reserve. So cold reserve is opposite of the hot reserve. It is not in operation, but it is in service. Spinning reserve is nothing but it is a 9 megawatt only. You can say clearly, yes, it is perfectly all right. It is perfectly operation, and it is also giving the service to meet the load demand. Okay? So it is in operation as well as it is giving the service to the load to meet the load demand. Okay? So this is a very important thing we have to keep in mind. Always operation is in service. The next concept we will try to understand is about the permanent impedance. So permanent impedance we will try to understand. Okay? So what is permanent impedance? Actual value by base value. So jet permanent is called jet actual by jet base. So you know jet base is nothing but so S is equal to V square by J. So J is equal to V square by S. So Z base is equal to V base square by S base. J ZS is equal to VBS by the SBS, remaining as it is. So I want to know the value of Z actual. The Z dependent into VBS square by SBS. So the Z actual will be same no matter whatever the power you take. Okay. So no matter what is the power you take, the actual value will be same. So here I am going to use the only system. Here I am going to use the new system. So Z dependent into VBS square by SBS will be equal to Z dependent into VBS equal square by SBS. So if you simplify, I want to know the value of the jet-product mean. So if you jet-product mean, so if you want to simplify what you're doing here, jet-product mean is equal to jet-product all into V base all by V base by one square into S base two by S base four. So jet-product mean is equal to jet-product all into V base all by V base by one square into S base two by S base four. So one shortcut remember, this is the old value. This is the old value and this is the old value. Okay. So like this, you have to use the old values. Okay. So the remaining two are the new values. Okay. Remaining two are the new values. Okay. This is a new value. This is also new value. Okay. It's a new value. Okay. Just to the square of this one. Only will be square value. So we are doing a voltage square. So what is the formula here? This is the old value. This is the old value. This is the old value. These two are the new values. We have the square root. Okay. This is the format I used to remember. So, Z dot mu is equal to Z dot one into V base one by V base two one square into S base two by S base two. This is a very important formula. You need to get this number. So, the Z dot mu is equal to Z dot one into V base one by V base two one square into S base two by S base two. Okay. This is a very important formula. You have to remember. So, now let me tell you some type of poles. And your concept is about the poles. So, basically, here in the column 1, I have given the different types of poles, and in the column 2, I have given the maximum span of the poles which are required. The maximum span is maximum distance. So, this is the maximum distance that can be kept between the two corresponding poles. So, the maximum span between the two poles is always possible, not more than this one. You should keep the maximum distance of this one. If you try to keep more than this one, then the side will be very, very high. So, it is not allowable. It is the maximum span that you can keep across the two poles. There are basically different types of poles. What are those? Wooden poles, steel poles, RCC poles, PCC poles and steel towers. We have not taken a PCC here. So wooden poles, steel poles, RCC poles and PCC poles and steel towers. RCC means reinforced cement concrete. PCC means pre-stressed cement concrete. RCC means reinforced cement concrete. PCC means pre-stressed cement concrete. Okay? So here we are not considering the PCC poles. We are taking only these four things: wooden poles, steel poles, RCC poles and steel towers. So for wooden poles, the maximum span is 60 meters. For a steel poles, the maximum span is around 50 to 80 meters. For RCC poles, the maximum span is around 80 meters to 200 meters. And for steel towers, the maximum span is around 200 meters to 450 meters. So all you have to know, there are basically different types of poles. What are those? Wooden poles, steel poles, RCC poles. This is the poles and steel towers. RCC means reinforced cement concrete. PCC means pre-stressed cement concrete. Here I am not blending. Regarding the PCC poles, I am not blending span here. For wooden poles, it is only 60 meters. The maximum span here is only 60 meters. For steel poles, the maximum span anode is 50 to 80 meters. For RCC poles, the maximum span anode is 80 to 100 meters. For steel towers, the maximum span anode is only 200 to 450 meters. So this is a very, very important part we have to remember. So now, let me tell you the next concept is about the insulators. So let me try to explain one important concept regarding the insulators. So in the column 1, I have given the different types of insulators, and in the column 2, I have given the basic function also I have given. Okay. So pin-type insulators, post insulators, stay insulator, circle insulator, square insulator. These are the different types of most important insulators that we are going to use in the case of power system. So, we will try to discuss the function of the insulator. So, basically, insulators are made from the porcelain. Insulators are nothing but they are made from the porcelain. And the porcelain is the combination of the kaolin, feldspar, and quartz. Okay? Porcelain is made by only three components. One is the kaolin, the feldspar, and quartz. So, only with these three components only we are going to make the porcelain. So, always remember, we are going to make the insulator with the help of the porcelain. Okay? And porcelain is basically made up of three components. One is the kaolin, feldspar and quartz. Okay? This is a very, very important part. So, first we will discuss about the pin-type insulator. what is the basic notion of wisdom? It is holding the high tension, over it connected on a straight running of force. It is used for a voltage which is less than 33 kV. So, the basic function of this is to holding the high tension over it connected on the straight running of poles. So, for a line voltage of less than 33 kV. So, it can hold the lines which are having a voltage which is less than 33 kV. So, basically, it is going to hold the very high tension over it connected on the straight running poles. It is used for the lines which is having a voltage of less than 33 kV. Two sensitors, basically these are used to support the bus bars. Two sensitors are basically used to support the bus bars. Stay sensitors, they are basically used to hold the stay bar. Okay. So stay sensitors, they are basically used to hold the stay bar. Second sensitors, they are used at the dead ends. They are used at the dead ends of the low voltage transformers, which is less than 11 kV. Okay. The line voltage is lesser than 11 kV. Then we can use the second sensitors at the dead ends, okay. Shackle insulators are basically used at the dead ends for the low voltage transformer lines which are less than 11 kV. Whereas stay insulators are used at the dead ends of the high voltage transformer lines which is greater than 11 kV. Low means for shackle insulators, high means for the stay insulators. Okay? So shackle insulators are nothing but they are going to use at the dead ends of the low voltage transformer lines which is higher is less than 11 kV. Stay insulators are used at the dead ends of the high voltage transformer lines, which is VL is given at 11 kV. Okay? It's a very, very important point here. Okay? Yes. So, let me try to compare this concept here. Insulators, basically, we are going to make the insulators with the help of the newspaper. And process basically made up of three different components, which is the kiln, pulse per and quartz. Okay? So, our filter, this is the basic process to hold the high tension or it connected on the straight running of the poles. It's having a line voltage of less than 33 kV. Post insulators are used to support the bus bar, whereas the stay insulators are used to hold the stay bar. Whereas the shackle insulators, they are used at the dead ends of the low voltage transformer lines, which is VL is less than 11 kV. Stay insulators, which are used at the dead ends of the high voltage transformer lines, which is VL is greater than 11 kV. It's a very important point you have to remember. So let me tell you some important concept and the other important concept about the relays. Okay? So, S means short transition length, M means medium transition length, L means long transition length. Okay. So, in order to protect the short transition length, we are going to use the reactance relay. Okay. So, in order to protect the short transition length, we are going to use the reactance relay. In order to protect the medium transition length, we are going to use the impedance relay. Impedance is also called as a jet, so jet relay. Okay. In order to protect the long transition length, we are going to use the Mohr relay. Mohr is admittance or Y relay. See, the unit of Y is nothing but Mo. So we can call that as the Mo relay, admittance relay or Y relay. Okay. So these first two are the non-directional relays. These first two are the non-directional relays. So the last one is the directional relay. Okay. This first two are nothing but non-directional relay. This last one is the directional relay. Okay. So now we have to discuss regarding these three relays: reactance relay, impedance relay, and the Mo relay. So, reactance relay, it is basically directional resistor. So, reactance relay is also called as the directional resistor over current relay. Okay? Impedance relay is also called as the voltage resistor over current relay. For the Mohr relay, Mohr relay is also called as the take first this one, then go this one. Okay? So, first take this one, then go for this one. So, voltage resistor, directional relay. Okay? Voltage resistor, directional relay. Okay? So, reactance relay is also called as the directional relay or current relay. Okay. So, the directional resistor or current relay. And impedance relay is also called as the voltage resistor or current relay. Okay. Whereas this one. So, whereas this one is nothing but this Mohr relay is also called as the voltage resistor directional relay. It's a very, very important thing. Always you have to remember. And here, what is shortcut? Remember, RIM, R-I-M, RIM, cycle RIM, cycle RIM. Cycle and people used to call cycle ringer. So that is a shortcut for the RIM, RIM, RIM. So here write the length in the increasing order, small, medium, and long. Okay. So finally, let me try to continue this concept regarding the different types of relays. So in order to protect the short transition length, we are going to use the reactance relay. In order to protect the medium transition length, we are going to use the impedance relay or the jet relay. In order to protect the long transition length, we are going to use the Mohr relay or admittance relay or y relay. Okay. These first two relays are the non-directional relays, and the last one is the directional relay. Okay. So reactance relay is also called as the directional restraint over current relay, and impulse relay is also called as the voltage restraint over current relay. Whereas no relay is also called as first take this one, then this one. Okay. So voltage restraint, directional relay. It is a very important part we need to remember. Okay. So reactance relay is also, it is always used whenever there is a wolf fault or the fault. So reactance relays are normally used in order to protect the equipment from the fault. It's a very important point you have to remember. So reactance relays are used in order to protect the equipment from the fault. Okay. In order to protect the equipment from the fault. It's a very important statement you have to remember. So reactance relays are used in order to protect the equipment from the earth faults. Okay. It's a very important point you have to remember. Now we are going to discuss another important concept, which is about the circuit breaker. Okay. So S is called as the rupturing capacity of the circuit breaker, and V is called as the operating line voltage. I V is called as the breaking current of the circuit breaker, and I M is called as the breaking current of the circuit breaker. So all of them are the basic formula. S is equal to root 3 into V L into I L. I L is nothing but breaking current. So I B is equal to, or I L is equal to S by root 3 into V L. So by this formula, we can get the value of the breaking current. And then if they ask you about the breaking current, breaking current is equal to 2.5 times the breaking current. Okay? Breaking current is always equal to 2.5 times the breaking current. So from this, what you can say? Breaking current is always greater than the breaking current. Okay? So what is this here? The rupturing capacity of the circuit breaker. What is V? The line voltage of the circuit breaker. IB is the breaking current of the circuit breaker. And again is the breaking current of the circuit breaker. So with the input VS and VL, try to get the value of the breaking current. And substituting this equation in order to get the making of the making current of the circuit breaker. So always the making current of the circuit breaker is always higher when compared to breaking current. So always remember in the case of circuit breaker. So you know S is equal to root 3 into VL into IL. IL is nothing but ID only. Okay? So ID is equal to S by root 3 into VL. Then what's the value of IM? 2.5 times the ID. Okay. So S is the rupturing capacity of circuit breaker, and VL is the line voltage of the circuit breaker, and IB is the breaking point of the circuit breaker, and IB is the making point of the circuit breaker. So always the making point is always greater than the breaking current. Okay, it's a very important point you have to remember. The next thing is the fusing factor. Is a new concept is the fusing factor. Fusing factor is the ratio of the minimum fusing current so that the fuse will melt by the radiant current of the fuse. Okay, minimum fusing current so that the fuse is going to get melt by the rated current of the fuse. Fusing factor is the ratio of the minimum fusing current so that the fuse is going to get melt by the rated current of the fuse. Suppose if the rated current is 1 ampere, okay? So, see, you know this 1 ampere, the fuse will never melt. More than this 1 ampere only, the fuse will melt. Suppose if it is 1.2 ampere, then definitely the fuse is going to get melt. So, the minimum fusing current so the fuse will melt is 1.2 ampere. 1 bomb to the 1 is nothing but greater than 1 only. So definitely that is the reason its ratio is always greater than 1. So fusing factor is the ratio of the minimum fusing current so that the fuse is going to get melted by the directed current of the fuse. Its ratio is always greater than 1 because what, see, if the current is more than the rated current only, then the fuse is going to get melted. Otherwise it will never melt. That is the reason. So the fusing factor is the ratio of the minimum fusing current so that the fuse will melt by the rated current of the fuse. Okay. Its ratio is always greater than 1. Okay. But if you want an exact value, exact the range of the fusing factor, it is going to lie between 1.45 to 2. Okay. Generally, it is going to lie from 1.45 to 2. Anyway, it is greater than 1 only. But if you want to know the range, it is going to lie between 1.45 to 2. And always remember one important point. In the case of fuse, the fuse is going to have the high resistance and the low melting point. So whenever you think about the fuse, it will have high resistance. It will have high resistance and it will have very low melting point. So why low melting point? If the melting point is low, then only within less amount of time the fuse can melt. If it is being easily melt, then it can open some to the equipment. So equipment is protected from the huge amount of current. Suppose the melting point is very high, it will take a lot of time to melt. So within a huge amount of time, the load is going to get affected. So that is the reason you should have less amount of melting point. The resistance is always higher. Okay, fuse will have the high resistance at the low melting point. It's a very important point you have to remember. So the next concept is about the plug setting multiplier. So this is a very important formula you have to remember. Plus, if they modify the ratio of the forward current by the relay sitting into secondary rated current of the current also by the CD ratio. That is a very important formula you have to remember. Plus, if they modify the ratio of the forward current by the relay sitting into secondary rated current of the CD. Secondary rated current of the CD into CD ratio. That is a very important formula you have to remember. Plus, if they modify the ratio of the forward current by the relay sitting into secondary rated current of the CD into CC ratio. It's a very common formula, always close, remember. So if you see clearly, this relay sitting we have to keep in terms of numerical value. It is no unit. CD ratio is also unitless. See, secondary rated current of CD, which one is ampere. Follow current also have a unit of ampere. So ampere is nothing but it is also unitless. So plug setting multiple is the ratio of the fault current by the relay sitting into secondary rated current of CD into CD ratio is a very, very important part you have to remember. So plug setting multiplier is the ratio of the fault current by the relay sitting into secondary rated current of CD into CD ratio. It is a very important part you have to keep in your mind. So always remember, plug setting multiplier is the ratio of the fault current by the relay sitting into secondary rated current of CD into CD ratio. It is a very, very important formula. So finally remember, plug setting multiplies the ratio of the fault current by the relay sitting in terms of movement numerical value into the rated current of the rated secondary current of the CD into CD ratio. Then the next concept is about the PMS. PMS is the ratio of the P by PM. PMS is the ratio of the P by PM. What is PMS? Time multiplier setting of an inverse time relay. Okay. PMS is called as the time multiplier setting of an inverse time relay. What is capital T? Total time of operation of the relay. What is capital T? Total time of operation of the relay. What is TM? Time corresponding to PSM. Okay. So TMS is the ratio of the T by PM. The TMS is called as a time multiplier setting of an inverse time relay. Capital T is the total time of operation of the relay. And TM is the time corresponding to plug setting multiplier. It's a very, very important formula we have to remember. So TMS is the ratio of the T by PM. Okay. TMS is nothing but time multiplier setting of an inverse time relay, and T is the total time of operation of the relay, and PM is the time corresponding to plug setting multiplier. It's a very important formula you have to remember. So finally I can tell you, TMS is a ratio of the T by PM. TMS means time multiplier setting of an inverse time relay. Capital T is the time, total time of the operation of the relay, and PM is the time corresponding to plug setting multiplier. So finally I can tell you, PMS is the ratio of the T by PM. PMS is the ratio of the T by PM. PMS means time multiplier setting of an inverse time relay. T is the total time of operation of the relay. And PM is the time corresponding to plug setting multiplier. So this is a very important part you have to remember. So finally, I can tell you, PMS is the ratio of the T by PM. PMS means time multiplier setting of an inverse time relay. And capital T is the total time of operation of the relay, and TM is the time corresponding to plug setting multiplier. So finally, I can tell you TMS is a ratio of the T by PM. PMS means time multiplier setting of a inverse time relay, and capital T is the time of total time of operation of the relay, and TM is called as the time corresponding to plug setting multiplier. So I request you to remember this formula. So by this lecture, we have successfully completed some of the important formulas of the power systems in a very detailed manner. So if you like the content of the channel, then please like, share and subscribe to the channel, and then subscribe to the like and button. So remember, if you new video, then the direct news comes on about it. If any internet is in your lectures, then please open the comment section. And will definitely include all those images in the coming lectures. Thank you so much for watching this lecture. Please smile and take care. Bye-bye.